Thank you, Julia, for beautifully reminding us of that painful road that Jesus walked that day 2,000 years ago. A painful road that today I am thankful for and humbly blessed that he chose to walk for me. Good evening. As always, I am thankful, blessed, and humbled to be able to bring God's word to you here today, especially today on this Good Friday. Well, let's get right to it. Today I want to share with you from the Gospel of Luke. And I'll be reading from chapter 23, verses 32 to 34. Two others, both criminals, were led out to be executed with him. When they came to a place called the Skull, they nailed him to the cross. And the criminals were also crucified, one to his right, one to his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing." And the soldiers gambled for his clothes by throwing dice. Pray with me. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for this evening. God, once again, I thank you for the opportunity that you've given me to be able to, God, bring a message. Lord, a message that I pray will speak to those who are listening. God, I thank you for what you did for us 2,000 years ago on that cross, that we have life because of your death. Father, we thank you. I pray these things, Lord, in your name. Amen. Well, for ages, humankind has wondered why God, the creator of heaven and earth, the creator of the universe, would pursue us. Why would he want us? Why would he even care about us? Well, I wish that I could actually tell you, but I'm not that smart. But I will attempt to break down these three verses and hopefully, maybe, just maybe, we'll get a glimpse of the glory of God, his awesomeness, his holiness, his mercy, his love, and his forgiveness. Let's go back to verse 32. So two others, both criminals, were led out to be executed with him. So throughout his journey on earth, Jesus was among all kinds of people. He was with the rich, he was with the poor, men, women, scholars, the illiterate, the prostitutes, he was with royalty. He was among the tax collectors, the fishermen, the lepers, the sick, the demon-possessed. He was with the forgotten. He was with the outcast. And so here on this journey to the cross, here he is once again in the midst of two criminals. God, Jesus was always in the midst. He was always among people, all kinds of people. It is here where we see the reminder that God desired for us to be with him, for us to have a relationship with him, his creation, with you and me, us broken down, selfish, needy people. He desires to be with us. But being with us came at a cost, a heavy cost. And so we look at verse 33. When they came to the place called the Skull, they nailed him to the cross. Well, one thing we got to see is that God is holy. God is, he is set apart. There is no other like him. He is in a class of his own. You could say that God is the greatest of all time. He is pure. He is perfect. And so now anyone who is the opposite, right, the unjust, the unpure, the unrighteous, they can't be in his presence. And God, being a just God, would cast judgment on the impure, the unjust, and the unrighteous. Now, if we go back and look at the Old Testament and the sacrificial system, right, in the Old Testament, we see that when people sinned, the impure, the unjust, and the unrighteous, there was a requirement. And the requirement for them to be able to be in the presence of God was to present an offering of blood, the blood of a clean, spotless, perfect animal, usually a lamb. So God chose this way to show his people that in order to be right with him, there was a cost, a sacrifice that needed to be made, and blood needed to be shed. This blood represented life. And so, in this way, the sinner realized that life, that of a perfect animal, was required for their sin. Well, Jesus became that lamb whose blood cleanses us all. There were never, ever going to be enough animals to satisfy the price of our sin. So Jesus took it upon himself to pay the price that we never could. He exchanged his seat of life for the seat of death, which justly so was our seat that we deserved. With his death on the cross, Jesus took your place. He took my place. He took the place of all of humanity. John 3:16 and 17 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life." God sent his Son into this world, not to judge the world, but to save the world through him. And so that brings us to verse 34. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing." You know, I believe that it would be too easy and maybe a bit reckless for us to think that Jesus was just talking about those who were present that day, the disciples that were there, those who had mocked him, those who had beaten him, the guards, those who were there. I believe that Jesus was referring to you and me. That when Jesus was talking to the Father about forgiveness, that he was speaking on behalf of all of humanity. For you and me and those before us and those that will come after us. Jesus was asking the Father to forgive us. We're all looking for forgiveness, right? There's a story, a Spanish story, of a father and son who had become estranged. The son ran away, and the father looked for him for months. Couldn't find him. And then finally, in the last desperate effort to find his son, the father put an ad in the Madrid newspaper. And the ad read this: "Dear Paco, meet me in front of this newspaper office at noon Saturday. All is forgiven. I love you, your father." Well, would you believe that on that Saturday afternoon, there were about 800 Pacos who showed up looking for forgiveness and love from their father? I love that story. It reminds me of the forgiveness that we are all seeking. Some of us don't even realize that we're seeking this forgiveness. But as we have seen here through these verses, it is something that is required for us to have a relationship with God. And that Jesus took that place. And that Jesus pleaded with the Father, "Please forgive them." And so Jesus, on our behalf, has asked the Father for us to be forgiven. And we are. God offers this forgiveness to you and to me today. Now, we're all looking for forgiveness, right? Well, I believe that if you have accepted that forgiveness, man, blessings to you. What a great thing. What a great thing that you've accepted that you have accepted God's forgiveness. Well, there's also another person that I'm talking to you here to here this evening, and that would be those of us who maybe are holding on to forgiveness, as in we're not giving it to someone else. And so this evening, I would love to share with you that as forgiven people, forgiveness should be given from us as well. And so tonight, you know, if you are someone who, I guess there are two different people here that I'm speaking to, those who maybe, or actually maybe three people. I'm speaking to those who have accepted the forgiveness of God. I'm speaking to those who maybe had no clue that they needed forgiveness from the Father. And so this evening, today is the day that you can take that forgiveness, confess your sin to the Lord, and begin a relationship with him. And I believe I'm also speaking to those of us who maybe we've accepted the forgiveness, we're walking with the Lord, but man, we're holding on to some of that. We're not giving forgiveness to somebody else. So this evening, I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you today. And I want to pray for you as well. Give forgiveness. Give it to those who you know are seeking it from you. God forgives us. Jesus paid a heavy price for us to be forgiven. We need to forgive as well. Believe me, I know, because there's been some forgiveness in my past that I was holding on to, and I didn't want to give that. And when I gave it, man, heavy load lifted off of my heart. And so this evening, as I close and as I pray for us here tonight, I just want to encourage you: accept that forgiveness that Jesus paid the heavy price for, and give that forgiveness away as well. Forgive those who have wronged you, who have hurt you. There may be some out there who they're not even seeking your forgiveness, but you know that you ought to give it. And so I just want to encourage you, give forgiveness. Let us pray. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for this day. God, I thank you for what you have done here tonight. God, I thank you that, Lord, that you love us enough that you want to have a relationship with us. God, that you love us so much that you desire for us to be with you. God, and I thank you that today on this Good Friday, Lord, that we remember that in order for us to be able to have that relationship with you, that a price needed to be paid and that blood needed to be shed. And God, I thank you that your son Jesus willingly gave his life for us to be able to have that relationship with you. God, I thank you for that. Father God, I also pray this evening for those who, Lord, those who maybe have not received that forgiveness or have not accepted it. And so, God, I pray that, Lord, that if there's anybody out there here listening to these words, to this message, that they've not accepted that forgiveness, they've not given their heart to you, Lord, I pray, God, that, Lord, that they see and that they realize that you have forgiven them. Father, I also pray for those this evening who, God, who maybe are withholding forgiveness from someone. So God, I pray that, Lord, that through your Holy Spirit in us, Lord, that God, that we will be able to forgive those who have hurt us, those who have gone against us, those who have wronged us, Lord. God, help us to forgive just like you have forgiven us. God, you're an awesome God. God, I thank you. I thank you that as we remember the sacrifice and the death that was here tonight, Lord, I'm so thankful and grateful that in a couple of days we'll be celebrating the great resurrection, that you came back to life, that you are alive today. And so, Father, we do, as we anticipate that day, we do remember this evening of the great sacrifice that you made for us. God, we love you. We praise your name. You are worthy. You are so worthy of our worship, our devotion, our heart. God, we love you. We praise you. These things in your name. Amen. Well, Easter is coming. So Sunday morning, tune in. Pastor Rob has a great message of hope that he wants to deliver to you, to us. And so join us. Join us this Sunday for our Easter service. Keep your eyes on our social media, on our website, and you'll see the times. And we just can't wait to be able to share that day with you. God bless you. Have a great evening, and may the Lord be with you.